he's a father, and I know he's a husband, and I know he's a farmer, so I reckon that's three ticks. And I've heard Neil share before, and I just really appreciate the way that you share it and the way that you speak from your heart. And one day I had Neil and Rosemary around at our farm, and I had a failure of an oats crop. And I said to Neil, could you come and have, because he's a cropper, and I said, could you come and have a look at this crop of oats? And it was really good. He spoke into my life, because this crop was only to get rid of weeds so that next year, this year, I would be able to put a beautiful pasture crop in. And so what I said to Neil, have a look at this, I don't know what to do with it. And he wisely said, well, the aim was not, it was never about this crop, it was about the crop to come. And that really blessed me that day, and I've never forgotten. Just helped me to stay focused on what the aim was. And so really looking forward to sharing tonight. God bless.
Thanks, Paul. I don't know how I go after I wind up like that, but anyway. Thank you, everybody, for inviting me here. It's really good to be here. I'm not quite sure how to go about this, but anyway, we'll see how we go. But I do need some help, so can we just pray for a minute, because I need God to help me, and I know he's here in this room with us right now, so let's pray. Lord, we know you are here with us, and we know that you have something to say to each and every one of us tonight. So we would just ask that you whisper in our ear either something that's said, or maybe something that's not said, and just bless us as we listen to what you have to say to us tonight. In Jesus' name. Right, let's start. Let me ask you a question. Why do you come to church? If you're like me, I've been coming to church all my life. I've heard the same message of how God loves me and has forgiven me thousands of times. Am I a bit thick? Don't I know it yet? Why do I keep coming back to hear the same thing again? Well, last week, Paul gave us a few thoughts on change, and it got me thinking. That's why I have to come back each week. Because the world keeps changing. And even though I know God loves me, my immediate human instinct is, what will this change mean to me? And we're certainly going through the biggest change that I've ever seen worldwide in my lifetime with this COVID virus. Coronavirus. I've got another question. Is all this change caused by the coronavirus worrying you? If you have a family in the state or overseas, I bet it is. If you've lost your job or closed your business, I bet it's worrying you. If you're over 70 or in a nursing home, I bet it's worrying you. If you're someone like me who likes to project forward for 6 months and have, I haven't got enough to worry about today, I'm going to have worries for the future as well. It will worry you. We think we have problems here, but I'm in a business that sells broad beans off Kangaroo Island overseas, and our buyer over in the Middle East was telling me last week that he predicts the death toll from starvation over most countries will outdo the death toll from the coronavirus by multiple times, because people were going to starve. They haven't got a government like we have that looks after them. They won't have any money for food. They've lost their jobs. They're destitute. This could get really, really serious. I mean, it is already, but it could get a lot more so. And the scary thing is that we don't seem to have any idea of what to do about it. Over the last 30 or 40 years in Western society, we've come to think that we can control everything. We got on top of polio, then malaria, then TB. We got on top of AIDS, in a bubble. It's come as a really big shock that we can't control this. But should we worry? The text I want to look at today is one of the most uplifting I can find in the Bible. It comes from Ephesians 1, verses 3 to 11. I'll read it out from my notes. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. Even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing himself to us through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. So we praise God for the glorious grace he has poured out on us who belong to his dear Son. He is so rich in kindness and grace that he purchased our freedom with the blood of his Son and forgave our sins. He has showered his kindness on us along with all wisdom and understanding. Now, God has now revealed to us his mysterious will regarding Christ, which is to fulfill his own good plan. And this is the plan. At the right time, he will bring everything together under the authority of Christ, everything in heaven and on earth. Furthermore, because we are united with Christ, we have received an inheritance from God. For he shows us in advance and makes everything work out according to his plan. Does that give you comfort?
Yes.
You were chosen by God. You are blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. Not just down here. Every spiritual blessing which we can't even imagine in the heavenly realms. You have been adopted into God's own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do. He didn't have to. This is what he wanted to do because it gave him great pleasure. And the last line of that reading says that God is in charge. Everything works according to his plan. Does that lift you above the human understanding of this world around us? So why do we worry? It's really difficult, isn't it? I believe all that. And I'm very thankful for it. But there still seems to be a gap between that and the day-to-day concerns at the moment. Not being able to see my mother in an aged care facility. Not having a job or a business. Not being able to meet with other people. I'm into questions tonight. This is another one, a very personal question. How do you see God? How do you understand him? What's the image of him that makes sense to you? For me, God is all-powerful and all-loving. I have no image of him. No bright man in the flowing robe and long beard. The only image I have of God is Jesus. To me, the two attributes that stood out in Jesus apart from other humans was that he was all-powerful. I mean, he could calm the storm, he could raise the dead. He was all-loving. He died for us. That's my image of God. Someone who is beyond my comprehension, but the bits that I can understand is that he is all-loving and all-powerful. So God, this is an infinite amount of power and love, decides to create something that he can lavish his love upon. He creates the universe, including this little bit we know called the Earth. It is beautiful, and he lavishes his love on it, just like we can on things we love. Our pets, our cars, what do you love?
those things can't respond. They can't show love back. So he makes humans.
And gives them the ability to love. But for this love to be genuine, he must also give them the ability not to love. So he gives them free will. So the nearest I can get in human terms to describing how I see God is as a perfect Father, all-powerful, as our Father seemed to us when we were little, when we were small children, and all love, to the extent that human fathers who truly love their children have to eventually allow them their freedom to make their own choices, even though they know that those choices might hurt them. And to the extent that he will always forgive those children and take them back if they choose to want that. A few weeks ago, three of our grandchildren came to stay with us. We have 10 grandchildren. The youngest, and I dare say she'll probably be the last, is a little girl called Quinn. She's 2. And she is the cutest thing I have ever seen. She can wrap Grandpa around her little finger with just one smile. We often talk about love and usually associate it with love for your spouse or your boyfriend or your girlfriend. It is wonderful and very powerful, but there are usually little side issues involved. Little annoyances or doubts which we have to work out to keep the relationship strong. Even as parents, we express our love for our children with some discipline at times. But as grandchildren parents, we seem freer to give and receive love from these wonderful little beings who can look up at you with such excitement and exclaim, "Grandpa!" And your heart just melts. At that moment, you would do anything for that little person. She is perfect. Absolutely perfect. Of course she's not. Quinn has a stubborn streak like you cannot believe. When she says no, she doesn't say no, she says no! And she means it. And so she spends a lot of time crying and upset when she doesn't get her own way. And I feel so sorry for her when she's like that, because I want her to be happy. But there is no way that I can help, because it is her stubbornness that is the cause of her sadness. Is that a reflection of our relationship with God? Does his heart melt every time we turn and smile at him? Does he just adore us and think that we are perfect? Does he feel this great sorrow for us when we are so stubborn that we won't see what is good for us? When we don't know enough to know what is best for us and insist that we do? When we know someone who loves us so much and only wants the best for us, and yet we think we know better than him. Is that what is happening when we worry about the changes brought on by the epidemic that we can't understand? Are we like Quinn? We're worrying about something that we will never understand, instead of trusting our Father, who does understand what we can and who loves us. We look after us regardless of what's happening in the world. Truth be known, the only person I'm hurting by worrying is me. It's time to turn to God and replace worry with trust in his love for us. In Romans 8:28 it says, "And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them." What does that look like in these current circumstances? Is God going to make sure that you have a job and you don't get sick? That you have health and wealth? Maybe not. Recently I watched a movie about how the prosperity gospel has made huge inroads into American Christianity. Anybody know what the prosperity gospel is? It's a gospel that preaches that God will bless you with health and wealth if only you have enough faith. And of course, give generous to the church. Most of the big names we hear of in Australia, here in Australia, such as Joel Osteen, Kenneth Copeland, Oral Roberts, Benny Hinn, Joyce Meyer, who run huge mega churches in America, and TV evangelism programs that people see here, preach this gospel. What they're really saying is that we are in control of our healing. In fact, we are in control of God. It's all up to how much faith we have. If we have enough faith, God will heal us. If we have enough faith, God will give us lots of money. It's almost the complete opposite of what Jesus preached about it being almost impossible for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of heaven. In Matthew 19, verses 23 to 27, he said to his disciples, "Truly I say to you, it will be hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." And when the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished, saying, "Who then can be saved?" But Jesus looked at them and said to them, "With men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." Jesus also said that following him would always involve suffering. In Mark 8, he said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." Jesus knew that following him would not guarantee us freedom from suffering. The world is a broken place. That's why we have such things as the coronavirus. Jesus promised to look after us in the midst of all the world's troubles. All we have to do is allow him to. In actual fact, what Jesus preaches is the exact opposite of what our Western society promotes as the ultimate success. The ultimate success in Western society is health and wealth. Health and wealth. The two things that are being threatened by the coronavirus. As I watched this movie, I began to wonder how much more Christian faith has been influenced by the society I live in. I have always lived by the creed that God blesses me in order that I might be a blessing to others. But have I corrupted that to suit myself? Do I always see blessings as health and wealth? Can suffering be a blessing? As I look back over my life, it has been in the tough times that I've drawn closer to God, that I've grown to be a better person. It hasn't been in the good times. It's only been when I've given up, I've been suffering so much that I had no choice but to hand the situation over to God. And have known for sure that if I get through it, it is God's doing, not mine. In those times, your faith in God does increase. I remember the first time I went to prison on a Kairos course to talk to prisoners about God, and we had 10 weeks of training, and we weren't to judge anybody, we were just to listen, love these people. And I got in there and I was absolutely traumatised on the first morning. One of them was earnestly explaining to me that nobody ever listened to him, unless he put a gun in their mouth. I spent most of my time that first day in the toilet asking God what on earth I could say to these blokes. I had no idea how to relate to them. And yet I saw God touch more of those blokes in there than I've ever seen on the outside. Nothing to do with me, it was God. I remember when one of my sons was diagnosed with stage 4 Hodgkin's disease. So late, hadn't had any symptoms, and by the time they found it was almost a certain death sentence. We couldn't do nothing. We just handed him over to God, because there was just absolutely nothing we could do. God healed him. my faith to another notch. Think of all the people Jesus healed when he was on earth, from lepers to tax collectors. They were all suffering. And when they were healed, not only did they receive faith, but also those around who witnessed what had happened. So I wonder if all this change, all these worrying times, are they going to be used by God to draw us closer to himself? I want you to imagine for a moment that you're one of those lepers standing by the side of the road as Jesus comes along. You've heard that he has been healing people, but that makes no sense. You know that that is impossible. He's getting closer. You have to make a choice, whether to step forward and ask for healing or let him go past. Are you going to rely on your own limited understanding, as my granddaughter Quinn does, and let him go past? Or are you going to trust in something you can't possibly understand and step forward and ask for the impossible? Or imagine yourself as somebody in 2020 threatened with the loss of health or wealth or a mysterious disease that you can't understand. Are you going to worry yourself sick over it because you understand that there is no way to overcome this threat in your understanding? Or are you going to trust that God is blessing you even in the midst of it? I'd like to finish with another passage out of the Bible, another very uplifting passage. You've all heard it many times. It comes from Romans 8. But as I read it, apply it to your life now, your circumstances now, in these uncertain times that we live in. And listen for what God is saying to you. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. For God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. That's you. And having chosen them, he called them to come to him. And having called them, he gave them right standing with himself. And having given them right standing, he gave them his glory. What shall we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can ever be against us? Since he did not even spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he also give us everything else? Who dares accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? No one, for God himself has given us right standing with himself. Who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us, and he is sitting in the place of honour at God's right hand, pleading for us. This is the important bit. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us when we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today, nor our worries about tomorrow, or our worries about coronavirus. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord.